Hello, my name is Maximiliano Ferdman, and I'm a web developer with more than 25 years of experience. Today, most web developers are using libraries for everything, and I want you to know how things work with vanilla JS, such as using the DOM API, creating a router for single-page applications, and creating web components. By the end, you will see that sometimes you don't need those libraries and frameworks. Enjoy. So to get one element, typically today, we use getElementById if it has an ID or query selector. There are other ways, like first child, in case you are navigating through the DOM, but the most common are getElementById and query selector. getElementById is from the first version of DOM. By the way, the DOM API has different versions. At this point, it doesn't matter. I mean, in the W3C, we have different specs. Okay, getElementById, it's not exactly for the original one, but kind of from the 90s anyway. getElementById is from the 90s. Query selector is more modern. It has probably today 15 years, something like that. Query selector will let you get the first element matching a CSS selector. So if you say H1, it will take the first H1. If you have more than one, just the first one. It will return one element. Have in mind, when you use these functions that are returning one element, you can always get null in case no node was found. So you're getting an element by ID, and the ID does not exist in the HTML. You get null. Okay, make sense? So here you have an example. This is the very basic JavaScript, like JavaScript 101 with a DOM. So you create a variable element, document, getElementById. You pass an ID as a string, and that's all. Have in mind that element can be null in case it doesn't exist in the current DOM. Okay? If it's query selector, you pass a CSS selector, such as in this case, it will find the first element matching that selector. It's a link that it's within a header that is a direct descendant of a section. And then you can deal with that element. You can change the contents, read the contents, add attributes, and so on. To get multiple elements, so if you want to get a collection of elements, there are many ways. Get elements by tag name. Get elements by class name. Query selector all. And get elements by name. This is not a full list. It's probably the most common ones. And from this list, query selector all is the only one giving you a static collection. Okay? And being library static, for most situations, I could argue that it's not going to make a big difference for most use cases. But we have a big difference. Okay? You will see that in a second. When you use functions returning multiple elements, if there are no elements, you won't get null. You will get an empty array or an empty collection. I don't want to say array because sometimes it's not really an array, okay? But it has an array-like interface anyway on every situation. So for example, here I'm using query selector all that receives also a CSS selector, but it always returns a collection. In this case, it's giving me the list items of an ID nav menu. Okay? That's, and it will give me a collection. This is a live collection, get elements by class name. Document.getElements by class name, important. In this case, it will look for elements with the important class. Here comes the weird part, mostly if you are coming from React or Angular or Vue, where we are used to use the latest version of ECMAScript. So HTML collections, so the ones that are live, they don't have all the modern array interface. For example, filter, map, reduce, for each. We don't have that. So when you're using getElements by class name, you cannot use filter or for each. The only one from this list that let us do that is query selector all. So if you make a query selector all, even if you are passing a class name. So it will be similar to get elements by class name, but that collection will help filter, map, reduce for each. Okay, makes sense? You can still like wrap your live collection and have those methods if you wrap them in an array using array from. So you pass array from, you pass the documents get elements by name collection, and then you can filter that. It's a little hacky, okay, but if you're used to functional programming in JavaScript and you like how that works, it's not going to work with get elements by tag name initially. Okay, so you need to wrap it into array.from to actually, for example, use filter. So now if I go to the home, I go to order. If you look at the URL, it says /order. Do we have that order file on the server? No. We can just fake the URL. That's history push state. And you can pass anything here. And that's what you will see in the URL. With an abstraction layer on top of this, we can have an array of routes and loop through the array. But I want to keep things simple here. So I can just make a switch over that route and say, OK, let's see if it's the /, or let's start with order. Let's do these two first. Going to do the break because this is JavaScript. And what I need to do is to, for example, do something with the DOM. Remember, we need to hide and show, or we need to inject new elements. I will pick for this part of the workshop to use the technique of removing the old page and injecting the new page. Okay? So we're going to remove from the DOM and put into the DOM. Where in the HTML for that, I have an empty main element. That looks pretty good for that. Okay, so I'm going to take that main element, and based on the URL, I'm going to inject DOM elements or remove DOM elements. Make sense? So what I need after the switch, okay? So after the switch, what I need is to probably to add, take that main element, and I'm going to call append child with the element that the switch has decided to render. Make sense? I'm probably going to refactor this as we are adding more features. But that's kind of the idea. And because of that, maybe we want to create a variable here. We can call this page element. We start with null. And then we append over the main element that page element. So what we need to do is to create different elements based on the URL. For now, the first part will be to just create, for example, titles. How to create an element in HTML? Document.createElement. CreateElement receives the tag name. So I'm just creating an H1 that lives only in memory. Just in memory. But I can take that element and change its text content. And I can say, this is the home page or the menu. And for the order, I can use something similar, but say, this is the order, your order. We will replace that later with something better. Is it done? Not yet. And you will see the problem that we have. That is a pretty common problem when you're doing vanilla JS. So that's why I want us to get into the problem. So if we try this, we can see something like that. It says menu. And if I go to the cart, it says your order. If I go back here, menu, your order, menu. This is a pretty common problem in vanilla JS. When you're injecting new elements, what's the problem? We are not removing the previous one. Make sense? So we need to clear the container before actually injecting new content. There are two ways to do that. The quick and dirty way, okay, and the other one. So for this particular example, both will work. I will show you both anyway. So One way is, before appending this child, clear this out. The quick and dirty way is we can take the main and change its inner HTML. Be careful with capital HTML and L. And just say empty string. This is a quick and dirty way to delete everything in the main element. Why it's quick and dirty? Yeah, because it's a string. Okay. We are not, if we have event listeners, we are not caring on what's inside. And yeah, what is the other way? Well, the other way that we have is that we could take the main element, and there is a property that will get us the child nodes. And also we have children. And what's the difference between child nodes and children? That looks similar. Well, children will give you an HTML collection, and child nodes, it's a node list of blah, 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 blah. What's the difference? Child nodes will also give you comments as objects and text as objects. For example, if I have here, I have a node. It's the empty text, even the new line character. So I'm talking about the difference about this and this. Here, I do have a node inside that is like a lot of spaces and characters. So I don't want that. I just want DOM elements. So that's why we use children and not child nodes. So anyway, you say children. And sub zero, if we have one, so we should check if we have one, is the first DOM element. And we can ask for removal. Again, just showing you how to do that in different ways. And by the way, can you see that we are making the same query twice? Well, we can cache that. How? Creating a variable or a constant. That is not really a constant. It's an immutable variable, but that's for another day. So we do something like this. And that will improve a little bit performance. For this example, it's not a big deal. And some browsers are also optimizing this. So it's not going to change too much. But now, at least, when we are changing the URLs, now it looks a little better. Remember our store that has two properties? What if we set the proxy and detect whenever someone is changing the menu or whenever someone is changing the cart? If we do that, then we can trigger updates in the UI. Make sense? So we can say, hey, someone has changed the menu. Someone has changed the cart. There is a new element. Or someone has removed something from the cart. And we can trigger updates. So we can implement this kind of reactive programming. Yeah, it doesn't look like Angular or Vue or React, but they're using the same techniques behind scenes. In fact, you can use libraries for reactivity, such as RxJS. It's a library that offers you more control over this. But we are using vanilla.js here. So what if we create the proxy? We can call this a proxy store. And we say that it's a new proxy of that store, and then a handler. OK? And now, look at this. Instead of exporting the store, and this is similar to the idea of a high-order function in React, we can just export the proxy store. So the original store is kind of private. Everyone that wants to talk with our store will do that through the proxy. Make sense? And on that proxy, we can, for example, implement the trap for set. Set receives three arguments. The target object that is being changed, the property name, and the value. Okay. In our case, we don't want to validate data. So it's not our purpose right now. So the first thing that we want to do here is we want to apply the change. So we're going to say, for the target on that property, we're going to actually assign the value. Because we are not creating a proxy for validation. We are creating a proxy for like updating UI, broadcasting that someone has been changed. There are many ways to solve the next problem, is how we announce that the data has changed. Okay? We can receive, we can implement the observer pattern, we can receive a callback, just to mix techniques. So if the property is menu, what I want is to announce that the menu has been changed. Announce to who? I don't know, whoever wants to know that. So I'm going to mix techniques here. And I'm going to dispatch an event over the window object. A new event with a name. Can I call it change? What's changing? I don't know, right? So maybe menu change? Yeah, but how do we know in the future if the window will not have a menu change? Well, maybe we can prefix that. It's a string. You can use any string, okay? Why window and not document? Does anyone know? I can use document as well, yeah?
It's because we now have two documents.
Because we have two documents. We have shadow DOMs. Each one will have its own document. The window will be one for the whole app. This is like a global event. Again, I'm not saying that you should do this in this way. It's one way to announce globally that the menu has changed. If the property, if the cart has been changed, and you will see this in action in a minute or in 20 minutes. And something similar when the cart has changed. Change or changed, up to you. And if you want to use ED or not, it's up to you. And this is important, set should return true or false in case that you accepted the set or not. And something like that. So we accept the setter. But the important part here is that we are not changing consumers of the store. We are just returning the proxy. That's why it's similar to a high order component, in case you know that design pattern. So now everyone that is reading or storing data in our store is going through the proxy. And the proxy will dispatch global, or it will broadcast global events on these changes.